I want to welcome our YouTube people. We're here at First Congregational Church. We are turning in our Bibles to Revelation chapter 17. We want to welcome you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, our God, and our Savior. We just got done praying for America, and we ask that you would pray for America, you on the YouTube land, that you would pray that America would do the right thing in this up-and-coming election, because never before, I think, have we ever had a choice between death and life, darkness and light. And so let's just pray that America will do the right thing and stuff, and just right down the line, install people that are godly. But what we're going to be looking into is Revelation chapter 17. We're going to take a look at the first six verses. But before we do that, let us pray. Let us invoke the power of the Holy Spirit. Father, we invite your Holy Spirit to come into our presence. We pray that you would fill this sanctuary with your love. I pray for the YouTube people. I pray that your love would go out to them through this broadcast, Lord Jesus, that they would feel and sense the anointing and love of Jesus Christ. Father, I pray for our minds and our hearts. I pray that you give us ears to hear what the Spirit is saying to us, eyes to see what the Spirit would show us, and hearts to receive that which God would give unto us through these Holy Scriptures. We thank you for your word, because we know all Scripture is God-breathed and profitable. And so, Father, we invite your Holy Spirit to open up our understanding of this passage, and that Jesus Christ would be glorified, and that by being glorified in our hearts, that we would walk more closely with him. In Jesus' name I ask this. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Revelation chapter 17, the first six verses. It says, "Then one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls came and talked with me, saying to me, 'Come, I will show you the judgment of the great harlot who sits on many waters, with whom the kings of the earth committed fornications, and the inhabitants of the earth were made drunk with the wine of her fornication.' So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sitting on a scarlet beast, which was full of names of blasphemy, having seven heads and ten horns. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet, and adorned with gold and with precious stones and pearls, having in her hand a golden cup full of abominations and the filthiness of her fornication. And on her forehead was a name written, Mystery Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and of the abominations of the earth. I saw the woman drunk with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I marveled with great amazement." Wow. This is John the Revelator, okay? This is John who was given a revelation of Jesus Christ. Now remember, that's what the book of Revelation is all about. It's a single revelation. It's not the book of Revelations, plural. It's the book of Revelation, singular. And it's the revelation of Jesus Christ. Now it just so happens that this revelation of Jesus Christ is filled with visions that God gave John the Revelator. I like saying that. This sounds almost sounds like a gunslinger, right? John the Revelator, you know? It's a series of visions given to John the Revelator, okay? And so there's a question. There's a question that a lot of, well, maybe not all Christians, but many Christians who like to study Bible prophecy would ask this question. What is Mystery Babylon? Is it a city? Is it a religion? Is it a country? Is it the United States of America? Is it Rome? Is it Babylon? What is Mystery Babylon? Now I want to say something. That word mystery that we read comes from the Greek word mysterion, which means, you know, it has a little bit of a different feel to it in the Greek than it does in the English. To us, a mystery in English means we don't know what's going on. But the word mysterion means a mystery that was once hidden, but now is revealed. And we have several of those mysteries in the Bible. The mystery of the rapture of the church. We know what that's about. We know what it is. It's when Jesus Christ comes and takes his church away. Okay? And we have many promises that Jesus is going to take his church away before the wrath of God. is poured out on the earth. And I think we've pretty well established that the wrath of God doesn't begin with the bowls of wrath or the last bowl of wrath, but it actually begins with the seal judgments when the people hide themselves in the rocks and the caves and said, "Hide us, O rocks and mountains, from the wrath of the Lamb." Okay? And so biblically, we know that the church is not going to go through the tribulation. Not for one second, not for one moment, not one person. Okay, there is no partial rapture theory. Okay, if there was a partial rapture theory, I think the Apostle Paul would have let the most carnal church, the Corinthians, let them know, look, if you guys don't shape up and become spiritual, you're going to get left behind because there's a partial rapture. No. In fact, at the end of Corinthians in chapter 15, we have one of the most elaborate, detailed rapture passages, and nowhere in that passage does it say that the carnal will be left behind. So get those. Those are crazy thoughts that come from people who don't really take the time to study God's Word carefully. They grab a hold of certain parts, and Peter even said that, you know, Paul's words are the words of God, which the unstable distort to their own destruction. So how do we prevent ourselves from distorting the scriptures to our own destruction? Line upon line, precept upon precept, here a little, there a little. Every major doctrine in the Bible is in Genesis, Exodus, and all the books all the way up to Revelation. You can find passages about the rapture in Genesis. Enoch walked with God, and then Enoch was not, because God took him. Okay? You can find doctrines about sin in Genesis. You can find doctrines about the end times in Genesis. It's the Bible is a unique piece of literature because its origin is from God. And it's from outside the time domain. God has recorded human history before it happened. Before it has happened. And most of Bible prophecy, it's finished, like it's already done. Because in the eyes of God, when he prophesies something, that's it. It's settled. Okay? Now, I'm sorry, I got off on a little tangent about Bible prophecy. But here we have Mystery Babylon. And the title of my message is this: From Babylon to Rome, back to Babylon. Okay? Let me say that again. From Babylon to Rome, back to Babylon. And my thesis is this: God will remember Babylon and pour out his wrath on her. Okay? Because we're going to see that Mystery Babylon is represented, I'm sorry, ladies, by a woman. Okay? And oftentimes in prophetic scripture, evil is represented by women. That's no commentary on women, okay, at all, but God has chosen, and some good things too, like we the church, we're represented as the Virgin Bride of Christ, okay, so it's not always the case, okay, and of course, you know, it's pretty obvious that men are pretty evil too, so we're, you know, all have sinned and fall short of glory of God, so put the stones away and the tomatoes away, ladies, it's all good, okay. But what is Mystery Babylon? Well, first, we're going to see that Mystery Babylon is a harlot. That's my first point. Secondly, we're going to see that Mystery Babylon is an adulteress. That's my second point. And my third point is this, that Mystery Babylon is a murderess. She's a harlot, she's an adulteress, and she's a murderer. Okay? And in verse 1, it says, "Then one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls came and talked with me, saying, 'Come, and I will show you the judgment of the great harlot who sits on many waters.'" That "then" is referring to something prior, right? Okay? And what was happening prior? Prior to this particular passage, we see the seventh bowl judgments. And let's go back a little bit into Revelation chapter 16 and look at the seventh bowl judgment. Because one of the things that we need to understand is that when the Bible was originally written, there were no chapter divisions, there were no verses. Okay, that was something that was added in the Middle Ages for convenience, so that we could quote it, so that we could go to it. Okay, and so this is a continuation of what's going on in Revelation 16. That's what Revelation 17 is. It's a continuation. And so we see in verse 17, it says, "Then the seventh angel poured out his bowl into the air, and a loud voice came out of the temple of heaven upon the throne, saying, 'It is done.' And there were noises and thunderings and lightnings, and there was a great earthquake. Such a mighty and great earthquake had not occurred since men were on the earth. Now the great city was divided into three parts, and the city of the nations fell, and great Babylon was remembered before God to give her the cup of the wine of the fierceness of his wrath. Then every island fled away, and the mountains were not found, and great hail from heaven fell upon men, each hailstone about the weight of a talent, and men blasphemed God because of the plague of the hail, since the plague was exceedingly great." Wow. Okay. Wow. The seventh bowl of judgment, God stones the earth for blasphemy. Why is God stoning the earth for blasphemy? Because the earth, by and large, has worshipped false gods. The 10 suggestions, right? No, oh, wait a minute, 10 commandments. One of the commandments says, "Thou shalt have no other gods before me." Our God is a jealous God. He will not allow the worship of false gods. And if we remember from last week, turn with me in your Bibles to Genesis chapter 10. We see the beginning of blasphemy, the beginning of false worship on the earth. In Genesis chapter 8, verses 8 through 10, we see a character by the name of Nimrod. Okay? Nimrod means "we rebel." Who are they rebelling against? God. Nimrod was a rebellious world dictator. He was the first world dictator. And we're going to take a look at what he did. In verse 8 it says, "And Cush begat Nimrod." I'm in Genesis 10. "He began to be a mighty one on the earth, and he was a mighty hunter before the Lord." And actually, the better translations say he's a mighty hunter against the Lord for the souls of men. That's found in some of the Hebrew translations, okay? But in the English translation, it just says he's a mighty hunter before the Lord. "Wherefore it was said, even Nimrod, the mighty hunter before the Lord." Okay? "And the beginning of his kingdom was" what? Babel. Babel is Babylon. And we know that the earliest form of idol worship was in the plains of Shinar, where they worshiped the sun god, S-U-N, not the son of God, S-O-N, in the plains of Shinar. Okay? And we're going to see that this is very bad. Let's see what God has to say about that. Okay? Well, first of all, we see that God has, he's stoning the earth. Because remember, the methodology that God gave the Jews to execute people was stoning. And you know how terrible these hailstones are? They could be anywhere from 75 pounds to 110 pounds. Now, the silver talents, okay, of Hebrew talents were 110 pounds. I'm going with that. I'm going to say God is stoning the earth with 110 pound hailstones with the fierceness of his wrath, and the focus is Babylon. So the question is, we don't want to be a part of Babylon, do we? The Word of God tells us, "Come, my people, come out of her, come out of Babylon," Peter tells us in the scripture. So we don't want to be a part of Babylon. So if you're wondering, "Pastor, if none of this has to deal with me, then why do I need to know what Babylon is?" Okay? And I believe what I said earlier in our call to worship, that the way we view the scriptures, the way we view our nation, the way we view ourselves will affect the way we vote, the way we treat one another, the way we just live our lives. Because there are a lot of people who think that Babylon, Mystery Babylon, is the United States of America. And they'll go on about certain, you know, Masonic, you know, connections to our early heraldry, you know, on our money, in our buildings in Washington, D.C. And I don't happen to hold that view, because I think that I don't want to develop my view of a biblical thing based on human construction or human money, okay? And we need to realize that paganism has infiltrated every single culture, not just American culture, okay? That paganism has infiltrated even the church.
He said, oh, not my church, brother. I have a righteous church. We serve Jesus.
Oh, really? Okay. Do you celebrate Christmas on December 25th? That has pagan origins. Now, I don't want to put you on a legalistic trip. I don't have a problem with you celebrating the birth of Jesus on December 25th, as long as you're worshiping Jesus and not the tree, the Queen of Heaven, and all that stuff that is connected to. For us, most of us, Christmas is a walk down nostalgia lane. But you know what? There are some Christians who will not celebrate Christmas because it violates their conscience. I had a brother of mine who he would not celebrate Christmas because of its pagan connections. How many of us celebrate Easter? Now, come on, Easter, oh, come on, the resurrection? That also has pagan elements, bunny rabbits, you know, Peter Cottontail hopping down the bunny trail, hippity hop, you know, laying eggs. Since when do rabbits lay eggs? Rabbits don't lay eggs. But you see, rabbits and eggs were fertility symbols of paganism. Okay? And if you understand anything about church history, there was a time where the Christians thought it might be wise to kind of incorporate some of the paganistic elements into their Christian belief so that they could draw the people into the church. Sounds good. Can be very destructive. And you know what? The church hasn't changed. We still have churches that hold an absolute premium on being visitor friendly, to the point where they take out songs out of their hymnals like Onward Christian Soldiers. They remove crosses from their churches. They don't talk about the rapture of Jesus Christ. They don't talk about hell. They just tell people, be born again, love Jesus, and your life will be wonderful from here on out. Well, I'm here to tell you, it is wonderful to be born again. But guess what? If you get born again, expect to encounter resistance because you've left the matrix and you've become an enemy to a world system that wants to destroy you, that is being run by Satan. Right? And no, he doesn't wear red pajamas and have pointed ears with a tail and a pitchfork, okay? He's actually very beautiful. And the Word of God tells us in Ezekiel, he was the most beautiful of all of God's creation. Okay, have you ever noticed some of the most evil places are located in some of the most beautiful places on the earth? Okay, it's because evil has to hide. See, we have the truth. That's why we sing, Onward Christian Soldiers Marching. We don't hide. The truth does not hide. The truth comes out and makes things very clear. And you know what? One of the things I should say right off the bat before I even get into this, if you're not a born-again believer in Jesus Christ, you're going to hell. You are an object of God's wrath. You are going to hell, and you don't want to go to hell because you're going to burn in fire, and a cankerworm is going to gnaw on you, but you'll never be disintegrated, and it's going to be forever and forever and forever. And if you don't believe me, go to the words of Jesus. Jesus said that hell is forever. Okay, and we have Christian groups who say, well, no, we know that the wicked get annihilated because God's merciful. No, Jesus said hell is forever. You don't get annihilated in hell. You will have eternal life. If the question is, will it be smoking or non-smoking? Okay, are you going to be in the new heaven and the new earth with Jesus Christ and with me and with other Christians? Or are you going to be burning in hell forever and ever? And that's why you want to know what the motivation of Christianity to go into all the world to preach the gospel. That's it in a nutshell. Okay. All right. That's freebie. Back to Mystery Babylon. What is Mystery Babylon? Okay. Well, let's just take a look at my first point is that she's a harlot. Okay, she's a harlot. The first two verses. It says, then one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls came and talked with me, saying, come, and I will show you the judgment of the great harlot who sits on many waters, with whom the kings of the earth commit fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth were made drunk with the wine of her fornication. So she's committing fornication. Now, what is God talking about, fornication? God's talking about spiritual fornication. When you worship a false god, you are committing spiritual adultery. Okay? And what was the penalty for adultery in Israel? Stoning. Okay? Amen. Stoning. So Mystery Babylon, she is a harlot, okay? And she sits on many waters. That's a very clear clue as to who she is. She sits on many waters. What does that mean? Well, we don't have to go very far. All we have to do is go to verse 15 of the same chapter, and it tells us what the many waters are. In verse 15, John says, "Then he said to me, 'The waters which you saw where the harlot sits are peoples, multitudes, nations, and tongues.'" Pretty clear. Is that the United States of America? Can't be. Can't be. Because we don't rule over other nations. The history of America has always been to build up other nations so that they can rule themselves. Now, we've had a change of philosophy with this current leadership. Okay, America might be kind of heading in that direction in some ways, but the fabric of our culture is one that people, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness is for all people. That all men are created equal. We don't look upon America as the place that should rule the world. In fact, the proof is in the pudding. At the end of World War II, the United States of America had the power to rule the nation because we were the only ones with a nuclear bomb. We could have said to the Russians, "Look, you become the 51st state or we're bombing Moscow into oblivion." We could have said to Europe, "You're going to be, you know, state 50, the 52nd state of America, or we'll bomb you into oblivion." No nation in the world has ever had the power to conquer the world and not try. When the Romans had their power, they did conquer the world. When the Greeks had their power, they did conquer the world. When the Persians had their power, they did conquer the world. When the Babylonians had the power, they did conquer the world. And there have been other people groups that have, Hitler, Napoleon, the Tsars, Stalin, Mao Zedong, these are all in, you know, the wacky boy in North Korea. If he had the power, he would conquer the world. Yeah, he's a wacky boy. I said it. Okay? How about Islam? If they had the power, they would conquer the world. But that is not the original spirit of America. If you study our history, our forefathers came here to get away from oppression. They came here so that they could worship Jesus Christ the way they felt he should be worshiped. In fact, the pilgrims were called separatists because they had separated themselves from the Church of England, which was trying to tell them how they could and where they could worship God. And they said, "No, the Bible tells us this is how we're supposed to worship God. We follow the Bible, not the king." And they were talking about the King of England. Okay? And so they came to this nation and they developed these colonies. And even some Catholic people came over. That's why we have a state called Maryland. Those were Catholic refugees. They wanted to get away from the Roman Catholic Church and worship, you know, in a Catholic way, their way. That's why it's called Maryland or Maryland. Okay. So what is this harlot? She is someone who has ruled over many tongues and languages and peoples, and she is a harlot. What else does she do? Well, it says that she commits fornications with the kings of the earth. Okay? Are you getting a sense of what this is starting to sound like? This is starting to sound like an ideology that wants to conquer the world. And because it's in the Christian vein, I don't think it's Islam, okay? I think it's another ideology. And that ideology would be Roman Catholicism. And I believe that Mystery Babylon is a complex thing. I believe it has a dual element to it. I believe it is a religious system, okay? First and foremost. But right now, foremost, a religious system that has ruled over the nations, okay? Do you realize how much power the Pope has had over the course of humankind? When one king broke away from disobeyed the Pope, you know what the Pope did? He excommunicated him. And the king was afraid for his own salvation, because at that time people in Europe thought the Pope had the power to take your salvation away or to give you salvation. And so he stood outside of the papacy in the snow and barefoot until the Pope forgave him. Because that's how much fear. When the hordes from China and Russia were crashing into Europe, okay, the Pope told the leader of those hordes, if you sack the city of Rome, you'll go to hell. And there was enough superstitious belief in that leader that he didn't sack the city of Rome, and they stopped their inroads into Europe, okay? I believe that the Roman Catholicism is part of this, but I don't think it's just Roman Catholicism. Now, before you go, uh-oh, pastor's getting his anti-Catholic kick on, he's anti-Catholic. I'm not anti-Catholic, because I want to remind you of the letter to the Church of Thyatira, which I think represents the Catholic Church. You know what God said to that church? He said, you have some in you that are faithful that I'm going to save from the day of tribulation, and you're doing more now than you were when you first started. And that's not a bad report card. I mean, there's some really bad spots in it, but there's some really good spots in it. Whereas in the very next letter, which I believe prophetically refers to the Protestant world, you know what Jesus says to them? You have a name that you're alive, but you are dead. However, there are a few of you, there are a few in you who have not soiled their garments and who are alive. But the vast majority of you is dead. And what is that saying about the Protestant movement? Well, let's take a look at history. Is the Catholic Church ordaining lesbian and homosexual priests? No. What about certain old school Protestant denominations? I'm not going to name them. Okay, because I don't want to get in trouble. But are they ordaining lesbians and homosexuals as ministers of the gospel? Yes, they are. What is that saying? The Bible tells us that in the end times there are those who would claim to be the people of God but deny the power thereof. What are they denying? They're denying the transformation of a human life. When you become born again, God gives you a brand new heart and transforms you into a new creature. That's why we call it being born again. You don't give birth to old people, right? Wouldn't that be gross? Right? We give birth to babies. They're brand new. And that's what happens when you become born again. But there are people who claim to be Christians who deny that power of the transformation of a life. And so Mystery Babylon is a false religion. It began in the plains of Shinar under the leadership of Nimrod and will end with the last world dictator. And some people have called him Nimrod as well. And it's interesting that the views of who the Antichrist is have changed over the course of study. Okay? And so what else is Mystery Babylon? Mystery Babylon is an adulteress, okay? She commits fornication with the inhabitants of the earth. She makes them drunk. Spiritual whoredom is worshiping false gods. And the proof is biblically. You may say, well, Nelson, prove to me biblically that worshiping false gods is spiritual whoredom. Well, turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Jeremiah. Jeremiah chapter 3. I want you to know that, you know, because we need to be good Bereans, okay? I've heard a lot of theories about different things, and they sound real good, and people put together these incredibly elaborate arguments that sound right on, but lack a scriptural basis to them, okay? And I want to base my belief on scripture, okay? I don't care about the Statue of Liberty or the construction of Washington, D.C. or what we got on our money so much as I do care about what does God's word say about certain things. And spiritual whoredom is worshiping false gods. And in Jeremiah chapter 3, beginning with verse 6 through 9, it says, "And the Lord said to me in the days of Josiah the king, have you seen what backsliding Israel has done? She has gone up on every high mountain and under every green tree and played the harlot. And I said, after she had done all these things, return to me, but she did not return. Her treacherous sister saw it. Then I saw for all the causes for which backsliding Israel had committed adultery, and I had put her away and given her a certificate of divorce, yet her treacherous sister Judah did not fear, but went and played the harlot also. So it came to pass, though her casual harlotry, that she defiled the land and committed adultery with stones and trees." The high places is where they worshipped false gods. So when Israel was worshiping false gods in the high places, which were what? Stones and trees made to look like bugs and creatures and people. And there was a certain gross sexual element to it as well. It was very perverse. And God is saying to Israel and Judah, you play the harlot. Okay? And of course, the number of witness in the Jewish community is two. And so let's get our second witness. I call to the stand Hosea. Let's turn to Hosea chapter 1. Hosea is right before Amos, I believe, or no, Joel, and right after. But Hosea chapter 1, verse 2, it says, when the Lord began to speak by Hosea, the Lord said to Hosea, go take yourself a wife of harlotry and children of harlotry, for the land has committed great harlotry by departing from the Lord. So when we have American legislators telling us that we should not worship Jesus Christ, they are inducing us to commit spiritual adultery. They are inducing us to become harlots in a spiritual sense. They are inducing us to become drunk with the wine of paganism. Do whatever you want. Do whatever feels right. If it feels good, do it. Don't worry, the circumstances be darned. You just, you're the boss of you. I'm okay, you're okay. No, that's not true. I'm not okay. And you're not okay without Jesus. What makes me okay, what makes me right, is being born again. That's what makes me right. The human race is not okay. Look at what we do to each other. How many millions of people do we butcher in our wars? How many millions of babies do we butcher in our hospitals through abortion? What wickedness and... I mean, good grief. There was an organization exposed for chopping up live babies and America barely winked. We're not okay without Jesus. But we can be righteous through him. Okay, so there's the coin has two sides. There's a bad side and there's a good side. You know, Jesus has two sides. Do you know he's our kinsman redeemer? That's a Jewish concept. Kinsman redeemer, redeeming people so that they can live an abundant life. Okay, he's also the avenger of blood. Because the same person who would redeem his kinsman would also be the one who would avenge his kinsmen. And what does Jesus say at the end of the tribulation when he lines up the nations for a judgment and he puts the goats to his left and the sheep to his right and he says to the sheep, enter into my rest because you, when I was in prison, you visited me. When I was sick, you gave me medicine. When I was hungry, you fed me. When I was thirsty, you gave me drink. And yada, yada, and the people there, because these people have just gone through the tribulation, they're going to say, Lord, when did we see you? He goes, when you did it to the least of my brethren. Who is he talking about? He's talking about the nation of Israel. And then he turns to the people on the left. He says, depart to hell, you wicked, because you didn't do all those things. And they're going to say, Lord, what do we see? When you didn't do it to the least. The people who blessed the nation of Israel during the tribulation, those nations, those people will be able to enter into the glorious millennial kingdom. But the ones who mistreat the Jews, the ones who abuse the Jews, the ones who attack the Jews, they're going to be thrown immediately into the lake of fire. End of story. And so only righteous people are going to enter into the kingdom, the millennial kingdom. You might be saying, well, where will we be at this? We'll be at the right hand of Jesus coming down with him. We'll be sitting at his right hand. We're going to be in glorified bodies. It doesn't have any... Now you say, well, I've heard preachers say, well, this is why we should take... When they read that passage, we should take care of, you know, the poor, the lame, the weak... I agree, the principle is the same, but I wouldn't use that passage. You know what I'd use? I use the book of James that says pure religion takes care of the orphan, the widow, the poor. Okay? I think preachers do their people a misservice when they use that passage in that way because it's specifically talking about the end of the tribulation, not talking about right now. We don't have hell on earth right now. You may think we have hell on earth, but this is not hell. And this is certainly not the tribulation. That is yet to come. All right. Mystery Babylon is a woman riding on a scarlet beast. And what does this beast look like? Look, let's go back to Revelation chapter 17. Okay? I'm sorry. I want to make sure we stick. Verse 3. So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sitting on a scarlet beast that was full of names of blasphemy, having seven heads and 10 horns. Whoa! Does that sound familiar? 7 heads, 10 horns? In case you've forgotten, let's go to see what the scripture says. Let's go back a few chapters to Revelation 13. Who is this beast? Okay? What is this beast? Is that the false religion? Is the beast the false religion? Is it an organization? I'm here to tell you, I believe it's a person. Okay? Because of Revelation 13, it says, verse 1, it says, then I stood on the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rising up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns. There you go. And on his horns, 10 crowns, and on his heads, blasphemous names. There you go. Now the beast which I saw was like a leopard, and his feet were like the feet of a bear, and his mouth like the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave him his power, his throne, and his great authority. And I saw one of his heads as if it had been mortally wounded, and his deadly wound was healed, and the world marveled and followed the beast. So they worshiped the dragon who gave authority to the beast, and they worship the beast, saying, who is like unto the beast? Who is able to make war with him? And he was given a mouth, speaking great things and blasphemies, and he was given authority to continue for 42 months. Then he opened his mouth in blasphemy against God, to blaspheme his name, his tabernacle, and those who dwell in heaven. And it was granted to him to make war with the saints and overcome them, and authority was given him over every tribe, tongue, and nation. And all who dwell on the earth will worship him whose names have not been written in the book of life and the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. If anyone has a hear, let him hear. He who leads into captivity shall go into captivity. He who kills with a sword must be killed with a sword. Here is the patience and faith of the saints. So the beast is a person. Now this woman is riding the beast. Okay, I think here it's an illusion. I don't think she literally hops on his shoulders and you know, but she's riding the beast to do what? Through a world religion. Okay? A one world religion. Do you know that the Catholic Church has plans to baptize aliens into their church? Yeah. There's a book out. There's a Baptist and an Assembly of God minister who did extensive research on this topic. Okay? And the Catholics have a telescope in Arizona that is very powerful. I think it's almost as powerful, if not more powerful, than the Hubble telescope. And they've been viewing alien spaceships for a long time. And I know that sounds crazy. You're thinking, oh, Nelson, you have flipped your wig. You're telling me that aliens exist? Yeah. I do. I don't think it's a matter of do they exist, but I think the question is, what are they? See, I don't think they're real aliens. I don't think they're green men from Mars or purple men from Saturn or Pluto. I think they're fallen angels trying to reintroduce a very hideous demonic attempt of fusing human DNA with angel DNA. And I know that sounds radical, and right now probably some of the YouTube people are turning off their YouTube and stuff, but I'm sorry. The Bible talks about fallen angels mixing with human beings. And it's not taught in our seminaries. It's not taught in our churches because it's too weird. Well, excuse me. The whole Bible is weird. From cover to cover. Explain what is not strange about a Judean carpenter running around the Judean lands, you know, Galilean and Judean landscape, preaching that he's the Son of God and that his blood will wash away your sins. How is that not weird? And we in Christianity have no problem accepting that. And let's take it another step. How is the removal of millions of people instantaneously in a twinkle of an eye, how is that not weird? That is weird. And how is the dead coming back to life not weird? That's weird. Okay? How is it that you lay hands on people, you pray for people who are sick, and they get healed? How is that not weird? It's all weird. We're a bunch of weirdos for Jesus. That's what we need to be. Why are we, you know, we've tried to make the church so proper.
Oh, say God when you're in.
No, that's not how it works. That's not how it works. God wants passion. We're supposed to be in love with Jesus.
Amen.
This is not a religion. It's a relationship. And it's a supernatural relationship. God talks to me. And God is talking to you. But some of you aren't listening. You've got earwax because you've become jaded and cynical
and scientific.
Do you know that most of the great scientists for the longest time were hardcore Christians? It wasn't until the German rationalists decided, well, if you can't rationally explain it, it doesn't exist. Well, excuse me, German rationalists, do you know everything? Have you been everywhere? Were you here when the world was created? No, but God was. And he has given us the Bible to tell us, you know, exactly what we need to know. But you know, it's not just the non-believers. We Christians do the same thing. God says something to us, and we don't believe it. How many times has God told us we are not going to suffer his wrath, but yet we got preachers running around telling the people, well, you're going to have to suffer some of God's wrath. What? That's not what God said.
Well, you're just misinterpreting the scripture.
No, no, no. There's a lot of these verses I looked at, memorized, and they all seem to have a common theme. It's kind of like the common theme of being born again. You know, if we escape eternal wrath, okay, God wants us to escape eternal wrath, why wouldn't he want his people to escape the tribulational wrath? Is it so inconceivable? God has an MO. He has a personality. He has traits. You know?
And you say, well, the church needs to be purified.
I thought we were already purified by the blood of the Lamb. We may not be as sanctified as we need to be. Sanctified means that we're following. You know, see, being born again doesn't cost you anything. It's free. That's the wonderful thing about it. All you have to do is believe in your heart, confess in your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord, and you shall be saved. That's it. What will cost you is walking for Jesus. That's going to cost you everything. I've lost friends because I will not deny Jesus. I've had family members deny me because I will not deny Jesus Christ. And it's you know what? It's all worth it. Because you know what God says? He says we have a glorious future. And Mystery Babylon, she's gonna get the wrath of God. I'm gonna finish this up. I know we're getting late here. I just can't help talking about Jesus. He's so awesome. Mystery Babylon is clothed in purple and scarlet. Okay, she's riding a beast with 7 heads and 10 horns. She's in the wilderness. Okay, if you know something, purple was the color of the Roman Empire. The emperors wore purple robes, and the senators all had purple stripes on their robes. It was a sign of nobility. The Catholic Church adopted scarlet to be their primary color. If you notice, Catholic churches have a lot of scarlet in them. Okay, and that tends to be their color. Okay, so I believe that the reason why John marveled is because he was looking at a church that supposedly stood for Jesus, but yet was responsible for the murder of the people of Jesus. And unfortunately, you look at the Catholic Church, and that's exactly what she's done. More Christians have been murdered by the Catholic Church than any other organization. The Huguenots in France were nearly wiped out by the Roman Catholic Church. Okay? But is Babylon just, Mystery Babylon just a religion? I don't think so. And let's finish up the chapter, okay? And we're getting to the conclusion. Because in verse 7 it says, but the angel said to me, why do you marvel? I will tell you the mystery of the woman and of the beast that carries her, which has 7 heads and 10 horns. The beast that you saw was and is not and will ascend out of the bottomless pit and go to perdition. We know that the Antichrist is going to die in the middle of the tribulation and be brought back to life. Okay, and I'm pretty sure that the beast that we just read about, the one with the 7 heads and 10 horns, that's the Antichrist. We saw that in Revelation 13. Okay, here is the mind that has wisdom. The 7 heads are 7 mountains on which the woman sits. And I believe that that's the 7 mountains in prophecy represents governments. And there were 7 major demonic world empires. You had the Assyrian, the Egyptian, the Babylonian, the Persian, the Greek, and the Roman. Okay? And the Roman Empire, it's got two phases to it according to Daniel chapter 2. Now, whether that second phase is Islamic in nature, that could possibly be the case, but it's still something of a revival of that seventh empire to that degree. And you look at Rome, look at Europe, Europe is becoming incredibly Islamic. Okay? And it seems like, you know, things are falling right into place on all that. Okay, let's keep reading on. It says, there are also seven kings. Five have fallen, one is, and the other has not yet come. And when he comes, he must continue a short time. That's the beast. And the beast that was and is not is himself also the The beast that was and is not is himself also the eighth and is of the seventh and is going to perdition. If you study the Antichrist, okay, it is a world religion, but there's two guys. Go back to chapter 13. It talks about the beast that comes out of the sea and the beast that comes out of the land. And I think that's why there's been so many arguments as to who the Antichrist is, because we don't understand that it's two people. One is a religious leader. One is a political leader. Okay? And the political leader is the eighth horn that comes out of the revived Roman Empire. And the seventh one is the religious leader. And that one world religion is going to ride the back of the beast. And we're going to see what happens to this one world religion. Okay? Verse 12. The ten horns which you saw are ten kings who have received no kingdom as yet, but they receive kingdom for 1 hour as kings with the beast. These are of one mind, and they will give their power and authority to the beast. They will make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb will overcome them, for he is the Lord of lords and King of kings, and those who are with him are called chosen and faithful. That's my conclusion, by the way. The Lamb's going to win this fight. Never forget that. And then he said to me, the waters which you saw where the harlot sits are peoples, multitudes, nations, and tongues. And the ten horns which you saw on the beast, these will hate the harlot and make her desolate and naked and eat her flesh and burn her with fire. For God has put in their heart to fulfill his purpose, to be of one mind and to give their kingdom to the beast until the words of God are fulfilled. In other words, this one world religion is going to be there by the support of the beast and its political system, and it's going to rule over the political system until the beast dies, filled with Satan, and then those ten kings are going to destroy this one world religion. And I believe that this one world religion is going to be made up of all different types of religions of people who are left behind after the rapture. And I believe that perhaps the Catholic Church in its perverted form during the tribulation might be the head of that one world religion, and it's going to get destroyed. Because if you study the history of paganism, it started in Babylon. Then it moved to Pergamos. Then it went back to Babylon. And then it went to Rome. And I believe that God is going to raise up Babylon again as a city. Why do I believe that? Look at verse 18. And the woman who you saw, that is that great city, which reigns over the kings of the earth. Mystery Babylon is a city that spearheads a one world empire. And Rome was initially that. And I believe that what's going on in Rome, okay, and if you look at the history of Rome, they've denied Israel's existence to a point. They've accepted it now. They've denied that Jerusalem should be their capital. Okay? They've fought all the things that we as Christians would support. Okay? They're trying to get into bed with all kinds of world religions and stuff, that, you know, with everything except for evangelical Christianity. But they've made a deal with the evangelical Christians. Do you realize that some evangelical Christians have promised not to evangelize Catholics? But the Catholic Church doesn't give that same option. And there are supernatural miracles occurring within this Catholic Church that are drawing supposed Christians into Catholicism. Miracles where Mary supposedly is revealing herself to people miraculously, claiming to be the bridge to God. So I believe this. I believe Mystery Babylon, it's not the United States of America. It's not New York City, okay? Although those things place definitely under the influence of paganism in some ways. But I believe that it is a city and a world religion, and that during the tribulation, it's going to move back to Babylon. Do you realize that the city of Babylon has been rebuilt? Babylon has never been destroyed utterly. If you read, and what you need to do for homework assignment, I'm going to give you guys a homework assignment, okay? You need to read Isaiah chapter 13 and 14 and Jeremiah chapters 50 and 51 and read Revelation 17 and 18. Read them all in one sitting. It'll take you 45 minutes, okay? And you'll see what I'm talking about. Because in Jeremiah, Jeremiah tells us and Isaiah tells us that Babylon will be utterly destroyed like Sodom and Gomorrah. Does anyone know where Sodom and Gomorrah is? Have you been to Sodom and Gomorrah? Do they use building materials from Sodom and Gomorrah in other places? No, they don't. But they do in Babylon. Babylon has maintained its place in history. In fact, the Greek, Alexander the Great, made it his capital. When the Persians conquered Babylon, they didn't utterly destroy it. They took it over without a fight. Okay? They slipped. I can't give you the scriptures right now. I'm preaching. This is not a Bible study. But I'll give it to you later. And I'm here to tell you that these things are being fulfilled, okay? And God's word is very specific about it. Now, I do believe that there are some new elements that are being revealed to us about what this one world empire is going to be like. Some of which I have initially rejected myself because I've been given certain things that are not biblical. I want scripture. You want to change my view on something? You got to give me scripture. Because I'm not going to accept the word of a person. I only accept the word of God. Someone told me, I like to read certain, Christian writers and it inspires me. And I'm thinking, that's great, but I like to read the word of God.
Amen.
Because that's what inspires me. Those Christian guys, they're great dudes, okay, but they're not perfect. God's word is perfect. God's word is eternal. And so, I believe that we're going to see Babylon, once again, rise to the forefront of the world. In fact, in around 2005, the United Nations said that they wanted to move to Babylon, which I'm like, please do. Please do. They haven't done that yet. What's going on? Why does ISIS care so much about Iraq and that area? Because demonically they're being drawn. You understand something? We are in a battle for the souls of men. And either we're part of the mystery Babylon system, paganism, or we're part of the one true religion, Christianity, being born again. See, well, that's awfully intolerant, preacher. You don't give any preference to other religions. They're good stuff. They do good things. And I don't care. You know what the Bible says about our good deeds? They're like filthy rags. Because every good deed we do has a lot, if without Jesus in it, it has an impure motive. Why do most Americans pay their taxes? Because they don't want to be prosecuted by the IRS. It's not because they really care about giving their taxes. Okay? Why do most people obey the laws? Okay? It's not because they're good in their hearts that they want to obey. They just don't want to go to jail. There's always in fact, one of my professors at Bible College says, there's no such thing as a pure motive when it's originated from a human heart. That without the heart of God, without the heart of Jesus. Now, I know that's heavy, but here's the lightness. You can have a new heart, the heart of Jesus, if you're born again. And if you've been a Christian for a while and you feel a little crusty, you know what the word says? If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Don't be part of mystery Babylon. Be a part of the true church of Jesus Christ. Be born again and walk in his spirit. Let's pray. Father, I thank you, Lord, for the fact that you have revealed to us what's going on. Lord, we know that there is a 7-year of judgment that is coming upon this earth. We know that we are not appointed to suffer that. Father, I pray, Lord Jesus, that you would help us to focus on what is important. Lord God, it doesn't mean that we can't take care of everyday things. We need to. We need to work. We need to support our families. We need to, pay our taxes and render unto Caesar what is Caesar's. But Lord, we need to render unto you what is yours. And we are yours. And our destiny is yours. And we belong to you. And you're coming for us. And Lord, you've given us mandates. You've told us to go into all the world and preach the gospel. You've told us that we are to study the word of God so that we can accurately divide the word of truth. You've told us to love one another, Lord Jesus. You told told us to that we are to love you first and foremost, but that we're to love one another as we love ourselves. God, that means we need to love ourselves. And your word tells us that we are fearfully and wonderfully made. Lord, help us to really look at ourselves from a biblical viewpoint, Lord God, because it's the only way to have peace and joy and victory and holiness. And Lord, I thank you. I thank you for the others who have gone before me. I thank you for the people that preached the gospel to me and showed me the way of eternal life. And I thank you for my brothers and sisters here. And I pray that you would use them to make disciples. And I thank you for the Cohens, and we lift them up. And I thank you for the Lears. And I thank you for Africa Connect. And I thank you for Agape Children's Home. And I thank you for Voice of the Martyrs. And I thank you for all these Christian missionary organizations and the street evangelists and just everything that the church is doing, Father God. I pray, Lord, that you would go before us, that you would begin to sweep across this nation, across this world, across this land, and that you would be glorified, Lord. And we thank you for all that you've done. And we ask that you would do this in the power of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen.
If you're a listener who doesn't know Jesus Christ, if you're not born again of God's Spirit, today's the day of salvation. Jesus could come back right now, and if he were to come back right now, and if you're not saved, you're going to get left behind, and you're going to have to meet the most horrible person this world has ever seen, the Antichrist. We at First Congregational Church don't want that to happen to you. And so we ask you, come to Jesus, accept him into your heart. And if you would just pray this real simple prayer with me, you can punch your ticket for the rapture on Airline Jesus. So just pray with me. Dear Jesus, I believe that I am a sinner. I believe that you are the Son of God. I ask you to forgive me for my sins, to cleanse me from my iniquities. Come into my life. Be my Lord. Be my God. Be my Savior. I surrender to you. I ask that you would do this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you did that for the first time, happy birthday. Today truly was your day of salvation. One last favor I ask of you. If you could just go and tell a Bible preaching pastor or friend, someone you trust, what you did. Tell them how you accepted Christ into your heart. Because there's something about speaking out what we do that builds up our faith in Jesus. Well, from the rest of us at First Congregational Church, we'll see you next week, and may God bless you all the days of your life.